Krishna is the first coach that we are aware of. But if you look at the previous Vishnu avatars, Sri Ram had also got two coaches. The first one was Rishi Vasishtha, who gave him the formal knowledge of Shastras, the Vedas, the Dhanurvidya, and all of that. What I call as the competence part. Now, then comes in the second Rishi, which is Rishi Vishwamitra. Now, Rishi Vishwamitra, unlike Rishi Vasishtha, is not a Brahman. He's a Kshatriya. He's a former king. He's a Chandravanshi king who has renounced his kingship and has chosen to open a Siddha ashram. He is now become a Rishi. And he reaches out to Dashrath and say, hey, can I work with Sri Ram and Lakshman and other of the princes and help them appreciate the wisdom that's required to become a great king?
Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a vodcast and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. If you are new to our channel, please consider subscribing to it and hit the bell icon so that you never miss an update. I am your host, Ashutosh Garg, and today I'm delighted and privileged to welcome a very, very senior professional, a very accomplished coach, someone who has a lot of knowledge of all the Shastras, Satinder Grover. Satinder, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ashutosh. Pleasure to meet up with a fellow coach and have a chat.
Thank you. Satinder is a business advisor and coach. He's earlier worked with Oracle, Tata Consulting, and other companies. And as I mentioned earlier, he has a deep knowledge of the Shastras. So, Satinder, let's talk about you and your role or in your avatar as an advisor and a coach. And let us draw upon your incredible knowledge from the Shastras. So, you know, when you think about it in our Shastras, Lord Krishna was probably the first coach where we have a recording through the Gita.
Yes, correct.
What are your thoughts on the role Lord Krishna played with Arjun and in general?
Thank you for those kind words, Ashutosh. I don't think I have a deep knowledge. I may have a bucket full of water drawn from the ocean that freshens me up, enriches me, and I also share a part of that with others. But that ocean is out there, and the bucket can't take credit for the water. It's the water which does the thing, and there is no ownership of the water. How I got introduced to this water and got access is it is through a couple of people, and I would like to acknowledge his one is Dr. Pritham Singh. He was the director at MDI and I'm Lucknow. The second is I've been deeply influenced by the writings of Devdutt Patnaik. And third is I got my introduction to coaching pedagogy from Coaching Foundation. But before that, even that, there was an interesting episode in my life where I was at BITS, and it's a graduate school, and because it's a university, you have both the engineering courses and the courses from liberal arts available to engineering graduate to enrich himself. So in my electives, because my GPA was under pressure, somebody said, why don't you take a course called comparative religion? A is sure in that. You can make an A and your GPA will look good. Well, the motivations were very, very different, but it ended up exposing me at a young age, and the seed was sown, which of course, you know, it develops over a period of time and that. Now, coming to your question, yes, Krishna is the first coach that we are aware of. But if you look at the previous Vishnu avatars, Sri Ram, Sri Ram had also got two coaches. The first one was Rishi Vasishtha, who gave him the formal knowledge of Shastras, the Vedas, the Dhanurvidya, and all of that. What I call as the competence part. Now, then comes in the second Rishi, which is Rishi Vishwamitra. Now, Rishi Vishwamitra, unlike Rishi Vasishtha, is not a Brahman. He's a Kshatriya. He's a former king. He's a Chandravanshi king who has renounced his kingship and has chosen to open a Siddha ashram. He is now become a Rishi. And he reaches out to Dashrath and say, hey, can I work with Sri Ram and Lakshman and other of the princes and help them appreciate the wisdom that's required to become a great king? And then there you have that whole stories of where he helps them appreciate that wisdom. So, for example, there's a story where he asked Sri Ram to bring Ahilya back to life.
Mm-hmm.
And Lakshman asked that question, but she has been converted into a stone because she committed adultery.
Mm-hmm.
And then Vishwamitra brings to life is that how much of punishment for what crime? A king cannot be eternal punishment.
Absolutely.
That justice has to be there. There's another episode where he asked them to kill a Rakshasi called Talaka. Mm-hmm. And again, Lakshman asked that question, but she's a woman. And Vedas say, don't hurt a woman. The question again is then, what is the woman up to?
Mm-hmm.
And that the king has to take a call. You cannot be bound by rules.
Right.
You have to have that wisdom. So that's the first introduction you see of elements of wisdom beyond competence being imparted. So if you see, the model is your capability is a combination of competence multiplied by your character.
Correct.
Right? Now, in Sri Ram's avatar, if you see, in the Indian context, whatever you see, when you see the avatar is happening, it's a extraordinary which comes down and becomes an ordinary.
Mm.
So Sri Ram, through his life, does not do any magic tricks.
Correct.
Even when Ravan is kidnapped Sita, it's not that he just flies off to Sri Lanka and retrieves her back. No, there is no magic trick.
Correct.
All the competence he demonstrates is within the boundaries of a typical human being.
Mm.
But what you see is phenomenal character. A character which is a combination of many, many areas. He's got humility, he's got perseverance, he's got self-regulation, he's got bravery, he's got the whole leadership, and he brings that to bear to create an army of monkeys and kind of helps them realize their potential.
Right.
And through that fights Ravan.
Mm.
Right? And the ultimate self-regulation that we see in through Sri Ram is one moment he is killing Ravan because he has to pay for what he's done.
Mm.
But look at, in that heat, look at the ultimate character that we witness when the other moment he's seeking wisdom from Ravan.
Correct.
And that is what, as leaders, we end up doing, right? One moment, you have to lay off 600 people. The other moment, your next meeting is with L&D, right? To look at what you do about the development of the thing. Now, what are you? Are you harsh with people or are you caring?
Well said.
Now, when you move to the next avatar where Bhagavan Vishnu comes as Shri Krishna. Now there it is another completely different element, right? You see the Kauravas and Pandavas, unlike Sri Ram, who got that transition coaching through Rishi Vasishtha, those guys end up into power and they have huge challenges, right? Yudhishthir has got anointed as the king of Indraprastha, and yet when he comes to that gambling den or the dwit for the game of dice, he's not able to control himself. He has no control on his ego. He ends up accepting the invitation, right? And ends up putting his everything on the table and to the game, which he had no right to do. Not only that, having lost it once and Draupadi then recovering it by virtue of the three boons she gets, he again gets enticed into the game.
Mm.
So that shows you that the huge challenges of character that exist, right? And I think the whole avatar of Sri Krishna then comes in the context of coach, where you have two parties, where one party through that entire exile and then through the battle of Gita is able to overcome their internal battle. So Mahabharata actually, for people actually, it manifests as a battle outside, but essentially the actual name is Jaya, which is about victory of the challenges within.
Mm.
And you find because there are two disciples that come out clearly which Krishna influences in a big way. One is Yudhishthir and the other is Arjun.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Yudhishthir, in my opinion, turns out to be even a bigger disciple because when Krishna meets them for the first time after they have been exiled, after losing the game, and they're all very angry at that point in time. They're very angry because they feel that they have been taken for a ride. But Krishna as a coach is able to reframe their thoughts.
Hmm.
And it is able to help them realize, no, they have not taken you for a ride. They have not been unfair to you. You could not control your emotions. Your self-regulation, your own ego was what led you to this.
Correct.
And I think Yudhishthira gets this very early on.
Hmm.
And you see his whole transformation in the 12 years when he answers the Yaksha Prashant, when he goes to that pond of water. Now visualize that situation where it's a very, very heat experience. All the brothers are lying dead, right? You're thirsty. And here comes a Yaksha says, answer my questions. Now, in that heat, to have that wisdom is only can be possible if the wisdom is truly internalized. And that's what our leadership is does, right? You
well,
have to be
perspective, yeah.
Right? It is that heat, right? To remember to be humble and to be brave at the same time.
Mm.
Like if the Sriram's example.
Mm.
And a normal guy would have done, normal king would have done. He would have cut Ram's head, Ravan's head, and would have gone around the thing and said Jingalalahu. But no. Here you have a complete embodiment of supreme consciousness.
Correct.
Saying, no, that's not what it is right. The right is, let me seek wisdom from him. And so I think we see Yudhishthira achieving a similar state where he is now able to answer the questions. And lo behold, look at it. When Yaksha asks which brother you want to bring back to life, it's completely opposite.
Yeah.
At the gambling time, he puts Nakula first. And now he has the wisdom, not only the wisdom, the ability to apply it at that moment and brings Nakula back to life. He's the first one he chooses. And that's a transformation, which is an amazing transformation, where a guy who's completely doing system one thinking, if I were to borrow Daniel Kahneman's analogies, he is now completely into system two thinking.
Mm.
And then the second biggest example that we see is of Shri Krishna now helping Arjuna in the right in the middle of the pretty much like we coaches do, right? Kochi is out there. His Mahabharata is going on. His world is going on. It's falling apart. Or he's got so many things. And he comes in the comfort of the conference room or a Zoom call these days. And it's the same dialogue that is happening.
Very.
It's a very interesting thing. And he's able to bring him out of that. Sorry, it was a long answer.
No. This is fascinating. I'm so glad you went into the Ramayana as well. I think you know, you're so right. You know, the personality profiles of the two coaches that you have drawn between Ram and Krishna are fascinating. You know, and even as a coachee, I mean, I think, you know, what Yudhishthira has got out of it. But, you know, now moving on, how did Krishna create a safe space for Arjun in the battlefield when everything was falling apart?
I think that is the most important part.
Mm-hmm.
See, as coaches, the fundamental thing is, unlike when you are giving competence, right, the business case is a lot more clearer because he knows what when I get that skill, this is what will happen. It's a business case that is outside you. But when you are trying to change somebody's character, now character is very much closely intertwined with your ego, right? It's like asking to change yourself. And that's why the simple thing is says be kind before being right. No. Krishna, obviously, he is the supreme embodiment of all the consciousness, right?
Absolutely.
He had all the wisdom. He can see everything. But it is the Sakha relationship where he is able to come down to the level of Arjun, not judge him in any way, not make him feel small in any way. In fact, at one point in time when Shri Krishna shows him its Virat Roop and Arjun gets overwhelmed, he says, please come down to the same loop of yours where I see you as my Sakha because it is too much for me. And Shri Krishna understands the feelings that he has and he comes down and gives him that same soothing comfort that he has of his friend, as his Sakha. And that is what enables Arjun to adopt it, a part of it. Now, the adoption is, Shri Krishna is aware that the adoption at that point in time when he is giving him the discourse, it's possibly just widening the perspective. He's aware of that. And just because you widen somebody's perspective, it does not necessarily mean when you again go into the heat of thing, the karma that we have to do. So the first, the Jnana Yoga, the elements of Jnana Yoga have been completed. But when you come to the Karma, you can still dither. So he, Arjuna, still dithers to kill Bhishma and then further with Drona. And as in coach, he is still there with him as Sarthi and creates conditions, again coaxes him, again through the action plan kind of provides him the support to actually enact it. Not only that, Krishna recites the entire Gita again in a different form after the war again, when he's about to leave for Dwarka and Dwarka, and Arjun says, "Oh, you shared so much with me in the battlefield. I don't think I remember all. I got it all." So he narrates it again in the form of Anu Gita, small, right? And it's, so he ensures that the sustainability of that vis-a-vis his coachee is maintained. So I think it's this whole thing, and it's pretty much the pedagogy that we follow today.
Correct. So, you know, one more question related to the Gita before I move on to the Mahabharata, before I move to the next set of questions. Bhishma Pitama, Dronacharya, Kripacharya, Duryodhan, you know, they also had a coach and coachee relationship.
Yeah.
Yet these such wise people were not able to deliver the right kind of messaging to their coaches. What was missing?
See, what my understanding till now, and it is evolving, right?
Yeah.
Why we consider Krishna as the ultimate coach is because he's the embodiment of Supreme Consciousness. There are no blind spots. Mm. He knows everything, right? Now, if you look at the character of Duryodhan, Dronacharya, Bhishma Pitamah, they all have blind spots.
Right.
Right. Now, Dronacharya is a teacher.
Mm.
Brahman by birth, Brahman by varna, Brahman by karma he has to be. Yet, he is participating in the battle. He is using his shishyas to settle his own scores when he sent them to fight a battle with King of Panchal. Then that's not what a teacher is supposed to do. Right? A teacher meddling himself into the affairs of student because he has his own personal desires and grudges. And that is not acceptable. And that's what Shri Krishna said. It's okay to kill a Brahman because the Brahman has not behaved like a Brahman. Mm. Right?
Yeah.
And similarly, when you see Bhishma Pitamah, look, when we were working, and the first time I remember we went for a vertical structure, that means our go-to model, the customer was very much around various SBUs. But the customer is the same, right? So we were given this belief paradigm, right? Company first, line of business second, team third, and you fourth, right? Now, I think pretty much like that, Bhishma Pitamah also got caught into throne first and everything later. But I think before throne first, there is society first.
Correct.
He limited his allegiance to society, right? A kingship exists because the society permits you, right? And if you see in the avatar of Vishnu, prior to even Ram, it comes in the form of Parshuram, right? Parshuram's whole theme of the avatar is to penalize Kshatriyas who are not following the Kshatriya dharma of taking care of the praja. It's for the society at large. And I think somewhere Bhishma Pitamah is possibly overdoing his loyalty to the throne and not following also the Varna Ashram. If there was a time he could have gone, he left it. So there are many things that are coming into play, which are, if you contrast it with Shri Krishna, a embodiment of Supreme Consciousness, there are blind spots there. And when the coach has blind spots, they are bound to reflect in how he will be enabling the coachee.
Fascinating. So I'm now going to move Satyendra to another coach who I personally have a lot of time for and I've read a lot about. It's Chanakya.
Yes.
Right. Now, Chanakya in 300 BC, actually, because of his coaching skills, got hold of Chandragupta Maurya and created three generations of one of the largest kingdoms or empires India has had. What are your views on Chanakya and how can Chanakya's teachings, and I always have Niti Shastra and Arthashastra next to me and I read it very often. What are some of those learnings and how can we take them into coaching?
I think Chanakya's character, in some sense, if you look at it, it is a blend. So in Mahabharata, we see Shri Krishna addressing the character past part. But in Chanakya, you see it addressing both the competence and the character.
Correct.
Right? and within the bounds of dharma. He and Chanakya are both are like in a way co-founders, bringing different form of sweat equity. If you say one is bringing wisdom, the other is bringing age on his side, the energy and all of that, right? But the key part is Chanakya sticking to the dharma part. He is not wanting to remove Nand for the purposes of any vested interest. It is because he wants equitable kingdom to be established. That's why you find actually, you know, Chanakya and whole Chandragupta Maurya's reign described in both Hindu texts, Jain texts, and Buddhist texts. Though there are differences, but all are very glowing about it.
Yes.
Which means there was a certain amount of equity. There was an equity for a different point of view. There was a shared vision. And that is what is very, very interesting about it. So Niti Shastra and Arth Shastra, it is not for self-aggrandizement, it's for the larger good. And that's where I think Chanakya is able, is an embodiment of Dharma. And the biggest example is this gentleman, Amatya Rakshas, who was one of a very wise ministers in Nand's regime. He's able to bring it over and say, no, you have intellect, you have all the wisdom. Why don't you serve it? And that kind of things can be managed by only somebody who's dedicated to things beyond himself. And that's why I think you're very rightly said. I think Chanakya's example is a more recent one, and it's an embodiment of somebody who works on both character and competence with equal elan, and is able to deliver result because he's following dharma.
Very nice. And my one more question, and I'm going to now come to the current age. You know, when I was growing up, coaching and mentoring was done by either a family elder or by a senior boss who took a liking to you. Today, coaching and mentoring has become a formal relationship that is evolved. My question to you is that what has changed where now everybody is, or a lot of people are looking for a formal relationship to get coached?
I think there are many trends at play. One is the whole concept of four ashrams, as was part of our culture, whether explicitly, implicitly, it was somewhere in your life, right? You get to retire, you come into this age, you're supposed to, it's time to let go and all that, right? Now, there is a fusion of cultures happening. There's a culture in the West, which is about one lifetime, right? Where you are supposed to accomplish everything in this lifetime and give it your best shot till the end. Versus our culture, where you have the four ashrams and there is a time when you shift. Now, fusion is happening. And then on top of it, the lifespan is increasing. So I think people are still trying to figure out with the increase. Now, you're living till 100. Now, obviously, you can't retire at 60. So this whole shift is happening in the family structure, because of which I think the room for formal coaches, formal associations like this is coming into play, because the seniors may be still engaged in active work. They may not have yet moved to Vanaprastha ashram in their minds. Right? So that is where it is. And also is because, again, I think it's because of the global world. You are not now borrowing your belief systems from one place. You are actually borrowing your belief systems from multiple places.
Right.
And that has led to it. There's no, I don't have a clear answer, but I'm just trying to say what are the trends that may be at play.
No, that's a great answer. So I'm now going to move to the last segment of our conversation, which are a few questions for you personally. I have time for two, maybe three more questions for you.
Yeah.
My next question to you, you know, Satinda, after such an amazing corporate career, so much learning, from where you stand today, what does success mean to Satinda?
Okay, that's a very interesting question, actually. See, let me answer it in a different way. When you initially enter into adulthood, and let's say you meet your friends or you are sitting with relatives and they remind you of what achievements you had at a kid, you laugh at them, right? Because your perspective has widened significantly. You say, that was not achievement at all, right? And I think now, having got into coaching and your perspective is widening at such a rapid pace, you realize that success is not, there is no definition of success. It's an event by itself. So is not a failure, because like you're able to laugh at things that you did as a kid, because you are so rapidly, your perspective is changing so rapidly. What happened in my 45 or 40s, I'm able to laugh at it. I'm able to correct. Forgive myself.
Yes.
And move on from there. Similarly, you don't look at that success in that way because you realize what a big deal it was. It, nothing great. And it was just a set of events which worked your way. And when you compare it with the audacious goal that you have given yourself to internalize that Lord Krishna's main theme that you're supposed to do karma with the right intent, and that's the only offering you want. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you are working towards it. It's an everyday battle. You forget it. You again get up. You forget it. You get up. But then that's what audacious goals are all about, right? So the whole definition of success has lots of meaning. It's about doing events, doing actions in a way that you can make an impact. So I think one is slowly discovering one's purpose. Mm. And that purpose gives greater joy rather than the success by itself.
Very interesting.
I don't know whether if I've...
No, you have.
But one is trying to stay in that. Mm. And you don't judge yourself at 40 when you wanted success in a particular way.
Absolutely.
And that was fine then. But today, with all what has come your way, the definition of success is completely gone. Success itself has no meaning, actually.
Absolutely. I agree with you. My last question to you, and this is a question on failure. Mm. I've often said that parents in India, South Asia, don't teach children it's okay to fail. Mm. You're always taught, class me first now, go to the head of the line, etc. And that manifests itself in our behavior patterns, which is why you and I live in Delhi, and Delhi, you will have three lanes at a traffic light and 9 cars there.
Correct.
Why? Because I want my car to be first. Is that
correct? Mm.
Yet, we fail. We learn. Mm. Mm. My question to you is, what have been some of your learnings from some of your mistakes?
I think my learning from mistakes, and I have committed umpteen number of mistakes,
absolutely,
is that every mistake is because your ego got attached to an expectation. You overvalued something, right? Fundamentally, that's it. Or at some point in time, you had a belief that was limited. You did not have access to wisdom that would have made you view what was happening externally to you very differently. Mm. So I think my learning from my failures has been that don't overvalue anything. What is important is the balance and is ability to move to different polarities at different points in time. And this lesson reached to me in a very, very unique way when somebody said, you have to be able to live across multiple paradigms. Mm. So, for example, if you see, when we look at matter as a whole, right, at atomic level and above, we understand it through Newtonian physics. Mm. But when we go to subatomic, we can't explain it through Newtonian physics. We have to understand it from quantum physics. And to wrap your mind around that, the part gets explained different way, the whole gets explained different way. Mm. Now, how do you wrap your mind around it? Which means you have to develop the ability to be in multiple polarities. It's okay. You can't be just caught up in one paradigm. Mm. And that is what that nothing is more valuable. Quantum physics is not more valuable. Newtonian physics is more valuable. Justice is not more valuable. Wisdom is not more valuable. It's all that is required at the same point in time. Unfortunately, when you faced failure, you gave one more value over the other. Mm. You gave some result more value over the other. And that's why failure happened, because your ego got attached to it. Or you had a self-limiting because you valued one over the other. You could not keep that balance. And that learning is the most fundamental learning. Again, you forgive yourself for not end. But the only thing that you have is you wish you had this perspective then.
I agree.
You wish you had this perspective then.
I agree.
And that's why you want to now share it with as many youngsters who, because we know that they will also go through the same Maslow hierarchy of needs, will be caught up in that same way. So you want to make sure that they don't get caught up in that same thing.
Very well said.
And that's the whole game.
Fantastic. Satyendra, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you for this absolutely incredible journey of, coaching through the Shastras. I think this has been absolutely fascinating. Thank you so much and good luck.
Thank you, Ashutosh. Pleasure speaking to you. Take care.
Thank you for listening to The Brand Called You videocast and podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website www.tbcy.in to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram and Twitter. Just search for the brand called You.